Well, good morning, everybody. Thank you for the introduction, and I'm really happy that the ILSI provides this opportunity for us to talk about dietary guidelines and how to devise in the future. And I'm really glad that my talk is really connected to the previous talk, particularly Dr. Fisker talked about dietary pattern analysis, data-driven approach, and hypothesis-driven approach. And this is something I will talk about in more details. So my topic is data mining to find protective or risk dietary patterns for common complex disease. Implication on devising dietary guidelines. I think most of us agree that food-based guidelines is critical because people eating foods are not nutrients, particularly eating foods in combination. So if we provide to people a very comprehensible guidelines, including simple, prudent principles to follow, and it is easy to implement, it is crucial for promoting health eating behaviors in human beings. Okay. I think all of you are familiar with the recent US dietary guidelines, and we heard about the salt and fat seesaw in the very beginning. And in this guideline, it stresses the follow a healthy eating pattern across lifespans, and also support healthy eating patterns for all. And with actually pretty much a lot of similar content, but different emphasis more toward the healthy eating patterns for Americans. And I use this picture taken from the guideline. You can see that briefly on the top. Still stressing the balance of six food groups to achieve healthy eating patterns, and also focusing at the same time to limit sugar, fats, saturated fat, and trans fat, and sodium. And I'd like to take this opportunity. I think probably rarely you have opportunity to hear the Taiwanese guideline. So I'm going to talk about the Taiwanese guideline that we developed in 2011, and we revised it this year. And we are also stressed so much about the balance between six food groups. You can see this division by caloric level for Taiwanese people and the six food groups. And the number of servings that we recommended for the Taiwanese people, which is evidence-based. And in addition to this, we, because Chinese are sometimes very short and brisk, so we naming our food groups differently by simply saying the whole brand instead of brand. And you can tell, for instance, for the second group there, for the protein-rich food group, we simply say bean, fish, meat, eggs. And it's very brisk in Chinese, so it's actually simpler than food-rich food. That is, standardizing for food, very long, and it becomes very brisk if you say the sequence of protein foods. And also low fat dairies, you just directly say it has to be low fat. And in order to stress nuts, so we put the food group oil and nuts. So this is just revised this year to bean, fish, egg, and meat, according to the new data. And also we reverse low fat dairy to dairy. One of the reasons is it's very hard to push dairy products in Chinese society. So we think it's more important to encourage people to eat dairy products instead of saying the low-fat dairies. Okay, so this is just a very brief introduction to the Taiwanese food guide. And in addition to the food guide, we have the dietary guideline. And in the very first item on the guideline, it is about healthy eating pattern by saying that you should follow the food guide, which balances six food groups and prioritizing food in individual food groups. In addition to that, we stress active living, plant-based, whole food, local foods, and nutrient-dense food, which is similar to many of the guidelines in other countries. And we particularly pay attention to portion size control and the same, our limit energy dense and heavy sugar-rich foods. Okay, so much about the Taiwanese guideline. So this slide just briefly mentioned that for establishing this guideline, we first identify current diet-related health problems in Taiwan, which actually is the metabolic syndrome. Taiwanese, even though the obesity rate, similar to many Asians, is not very high, but somehow we are more susceptible to metabolic disease like diabetes. We have much higher prevalence of diabetes than many Western countries. So we're considering our health problems, and we actually did very careful calculation using the nutrition and health survey data in Taiwan to generate the distribution of six food groups using 24-hour food court data. And we noticed that if we follow our previous, before the 2011 guidelines, actually the recommended diet is low, particularly magnesium and vitamin B6. So that is why in the previous slide I showed you that we stress whole grain and nuts in order to increase the intake of magnesium and vitamin B6 and finally we start. And we know that I think it's very important to stress the culture sensitive plant foods, local foods, and nutrient dense foods. Okay. We know that it is very important to focus on dietary pattern in the U.S. guideline as well as many other guidelines. People are using the information, some well-known beneficial dietary patterns, including Mediterranean diet, DASH diet, Japanese diet, or a lot of findings in the literature about vegetable food-rich dietary pattern versus the traditional Western patterns. I think it's very important, but how shall we improve our guidelines? I think it's very important to do more research in terms of dietary pattern analysis. And Dr. Bisberg talking, I'm very glad that she has mentioned different approaches. Today, I will focus more on the data-driven approach of data mining. Okay. For this purpose, because we are interested in the usual intake that will lead to different health conditions, it's very important that we should use a methodology such as food frequency method to get an idea about how people usually eat a method that can really differentiate people in terms of ranking their food intake, ranking their nutrient intake. So the data I'm going to share with you are all based on the food frequency data from now on for the Taiwanese survey. And very often in the literature, particularly in the past decades, people using methods such as factor analysis, and you heard just now, and it creates a linear combination of different foods and linear combination of different consumption frequency and to show a dietary pattern. But this kind of analysis, this is just an illustration, very often in the method they will rotate the information so that to create many independent dietary components, combination components. And this approach focus more on the nature and variation of the diet. It focuses less on how much it explains the outcomes. So I think its capacity is limited. But I'm just giving you an example with the Taiwanese data. unfavorable overall school performance using over 2,000 students. With this data, the frequency data, we find several factors. For instance, a high fat snack correlated with cookie, candy, chocolate, instant noodles, fried food and sugary high fat food, and sugary drinks. It shows that when a person, this is a really a linear combination, you can see the score here, factor loading combine all this together. It means if a children like high fat snack, chances are he or she also like fried food, sugar drink. So this kind of pattern can tell us a lot about the information. And also, we can get this healthy food nutrient dense pattern. Children like meat will like fish, vegetables, fruit, and eggs all together. And also, we can see some ice products and some dairy products. Okay, this is just an illustration of how this method works. It focuses on the food rather than alcohol disease. So I would like to propose that probably it's better to use some other methods like reduced rank regression in the middle. It expands more, as much response variable variation as possible. And also probably something like the last one, partial least squared discriminant analysis for categorical response variable. The middle one is for continuous variable, like some blood chemistry variables. And both of these methods explain the health outcome. So it may provide some new information. Okay. And so I probably skip this. Yeah, this is just space allocation. Okay, so I'm going to show you some data about different endpoints rather than hypertension, diabetes that we are, you know, often talked about. What about food that can explain something like asthma, hyperuricemia, nasopharyngeal cancer, and frailty? So the information, dietary frequency information is listed here, so I will not go into details. In a nutshell, we have to categorize the food properly so that we can come up with good information. And the first study I'd like to talk about is the nasopharyngeal cancer, which is published last year. This is the case control study. We use partial least squared discriminant analysis because we're dealing with a categorical variable, cancer versus no cancer. And so what we study more than 258 patients and equal number of controls, and they are comparable. And what we found is a pattern shows here is fruits with a loading factor of -0.43, the highest number, actual number, so it means the food influence a lot of this dietary pattern. And a correlated frequency of milk, fresh fish, vegetable, tea, and eggs. So this is a combination that protects people, particularly most of people are with EB virus infection, protect them from developing an NPC. I would like to, so I probably skip that. And we can show that the combination of the score, if you make a quartile, the people with the highest profile will have the lowest risk, about one-third of the risk of those who have poor in the Q1, okay? And it's a model with the result, how it's the same. So we found here that the NPC protecting the diet, which indicated with more fruit, vegetable, milk, protein-rich foods, and particularly fresh fish and eggs. And I like to draw your attention to tea. Tea is protected from the data driven. So this information may be used to design potential dietary regimen for NPC prevention and probably dietary guidelines. So this is just first example. And the second example is a pattern associated with frailty, and we use the data from the Nutrition and Health Survey in Taiwan very recently. It's published in Geriatric Society. And for this case, the endpoint is a linear continuous variable with a scale from 0 to 5. And people will score 1 if they have one of each of these symptoms, weakness, slowness, weight loss, fatigue, and low physical activities. So by doing the reduced strength regression, it's a dynamic reduction approach, we found this combination and vegetable stands out, and also tea stands out. So we can see phytonutrient rich, not only foods, but also drinks like tea. And you can see vegetable here, whole grains here, nuts and seeds here. And the protein are all low saturated fat, protein like shellfish, deep sea fish, poultry. Okay. And with this score, we classify people to three groups. You can see that the people with the higher score do better in weight loss, in exhaustion, in grip strength, and in lean mass, and also their hemoglobin values. This is elderly people above 65 years old, an average of 75 years old of age, okay? And so here, we notice a dietary pattern with phytonutrient-rich plant foods, including vegetable, whole grain nuts, and also the tea, deep sea fish, and other low saturated fat containing proteins. And actually, there's a discretionary calories between meals for this pattern in there, but less beverages. Okay, so we see some commonality even for very different syndromes. Here, frailty compared to NPC, we just described to you. And very quickly, I will show you an analysis for hyperuricemia. We're simply using the uric acid level in the blood to find the dietary pattern. Okay, and so I will describe it slightly differently. We can find the pattern, we found the pattern, and we can see that people with different uric acid levels, their pattern score differs continuously. And if we study the distribution of foods, you can see that going to the right-hand side with the higher value, you can see that the lean meat decreased, soy decreased, eggs decreased, vegetables decreased. And in the next slide, you can see that coffee decreased tremendously, carrots, mushrooms, but bamboo shoot, a purine-rich food will go up, and your internal organs goes up, soda drinks goes up. So it's very clear, and it's validated by doing men and women separately. You can see exactly the same pattern for men, for women, compared to those I just showed you for men, exactly the same patterns. So I will just go quickly and come to the conclusion of this part. So food positively associated with hyperuricemia is something like soda drinks, sweet drinks, internal organs, which is high fat, and bamboo shoot, which is high urine. But we find that most of the vegetables, including mushroom, okay, and lean meat, salt, eggs, are negatively associated with the uric acid level in the blood. I like to draw your attention, coffee will stand out in this kind of analysis. So we can see some insight into the food associated with different biological phenomena. And at the end, I'm going to share with you the asthma. We can use the ISAAC questionnaires as a score for dependent variable to determine the dietary patterns in more than 2,000 Taiwanese students. So ISAA. See, it's actually a questionnaire asking about the symptoms of asthma, and it becomes a score. So I will not say too much about it. Just quickly go through this questionnaire. And we divide the dietary pattern use again, reduced rank regression. You can see that the score actually associated with the current asthma status and current severe asthma status. And what is the food pattern like? If the score is higher, the children actually consume more high-fat snacks, more cheese, more fast foods, more candy, but less rice, less fruits, and less vegetables. So this kind of pattern goes together associated with the asthma risk. So in summary, I like to put all of the findings together. I think it shows something very, very interesting. I didn't have the slide for school performance, okay, but I will summarize it here. You can see on the top, for vegetables. Vegetables is protected for all the syndromes, different syndromes I described to you just now. We see that for uric acid analysis, all vegetables but bamboo shoot are related to uric acid. And fruit, the second line, it protects for all the syndrome I just described to you. So it really in line with the dietary guidelines. But for protein-rich foods, you can see that internal organs, it is adversely associated with hyperuricemia. And all the so-called wall-thin saturated containing proteins, shellfish, deep sea fish, poultry, fish and eggs, are protected for different things, including MPC and frailty. And dairies, they are different kinds of dairy. Dairy group is protected in terms of food performances, but certain things, fast food, is harmful or negatively associated with asthma. And in terms of carbohydrate, you can really see rice versus sweet drinks and instant noodles and sweetened beverages. So the rice and whole grain are protected. Other things are harmful. And I like to draw your attention particularly to fat. You can see that high fat and also those foods containing both fat and sugar is bad for food performance. And also for asthma, high fat snack, fast food, that is not good for asthma. And nowadays we study this fat issue, we found out that the frying process really something we need to think about. And but this issue is very controversial now with the epidemiological data in the world. And we think it's probably something to do with the oil quality. In Asian countries, very interesting, we all use soy bean oil to fry the food. But in Western countries and Mediterranean regions, different oils are used and different degree of saturation. And I think probably that added to why we find more about fried food or fat-rich foods negatively associated with certain health outcomes. Okay, and we noticed that natural beverages very often stand out to be protected. And I thought, that's something, shouldn't we think about that in dietary guidelines and to tell people about the natural drinks? Okay, so in summary, we use data mining approach to find well-being related dietary habits, and as I told you about the protective factor and adversely associated factor that I will not repeat. So to elaborate a little bit more, current dietary guidelines and food guides focus recommend general health eating patterns to follow. And to stress, should be followed, of course, lifespan. But people would experience some changing needs in different periods of life cycle and different subgroups, such as women at childbearing age, men susceptible to hyperuricemia and gout, and elders susceptible to frailty and dementia. So more and more dimension reduction tools are made available so that we can use it to find dietary patterns associated with various disease outcomes. And I talked about RRR and partial risk square distribution analysis. We think it's important to maximize your variation planned, not only for diet, but also for health outcomes to get information. I think certain individual foods or drinks stand out, we should pay attention to it. Okay. And so I think we need to think about also the precision nutrition, fine tuning for dietary guidelines for different outcomes and for different individuals. And for that purpose, I think comprehensive food frequency data collection should be valued. Because without that, we cannot dig out important dietary information such as natural beverages and cooking methods and so on. Thank you for your attention.